All right, well, welcome to our thyroid webinar. If you tuned in, you know, to the webinar on Tuesday night, you'll realize, and you're tuning in now to watch the replay, you realize I'm wearing a different shirt because this is actually a reshoot of the thyroid disease webinar. So we got a lot of great feedback from everybody that tuned in on Tuesday night, but I had some technical difficulties getting the slides pulled up, and it was 100% my fault. I figured out exactly what I was doing wrong, but I didn't feel like it was acceptable to put that out onto the internet with the way that the slides were. So we're gonna reshoot it. It's actually gonna be better. We're gonna be able to take out some of the things because we did some giveaways and things like that. So it's actually gonna be shorter and, you know, second time's a charm. So first thing I'm gonna do is pull up my slideshow here. Okay, so just like that. So, you know, thyroid disease, thyroid function, you know, I like that name thyroid function because that is really, you know, going to be more what we're talking about today. I didn't need to pull that up yet and take it down. So, you know, thyroid function is more important than thyroid disease, quite frankly, because if you understand the way that the thyroid functions, you have a much better chance of understanding thyroid disease. And that's, you know, the problem is that we're going to go through stats, of course, but thyroid disease is, you know, epidemic in our country. And 60% of people that have it are unaware that they even have a thyroid condition because it associates with a lot of other health conditions. Okay. And so I'm going to use a couple analogies tonight as always, but you know, the first analogy is probably the least important one, but it just to show the importance of the thyroid gland. The thyroid gland is like, you know, the most important gear in a machine, or maybe one of the more important parts in your car. Okay, so it's part of an overall working machine, but without that one piece, without that one piece working properly, you're going to have issues. So thyroid hormone, you know, every single cell in your body has receptors for thyroid hormone. So every single cell is important for every single function. But you know, thyroid is incredibly important for your metabolism, weight loss, weight gain, temperature control. Really, really important for these basic metabolic functions. Really, really important for just all your other hormones to work in harmony. So your thyroid gland is incredibly, incredibly important piece of your real health puzzle. Okay, and that's what I want to show you next is what does that mean, you know, real health puzzle, because that's something that we're going to look at from the lens today of the real health pyramid. This is something that I'm really excited about. You guys may know that, you know, I'm the host of the Real Health Podcast. We do our Real Health Stories on our website, but we've developed this program here with the Real Health Resource with what's called the 10 Building Blocks of real health. Okay. And so if you look at this, you know, the way that any pyramid is designed, you know, we're familiar with the food pyramid. And the point of it is that the foundation, the bottom part, is the foundation. You can't build a house without a foundation. You can't, you know, build anything without starting from the ground and working up. So the foundation of real health are a couple things down here. You know, your diet and exercise. Most people know that. Okay, so diet and exercise, foundation of real health. But also in there is the brain and the nervous system health. Really, really important. You know, you talk about something like dementia and Alzheimer's. That's the number one fear of seniors today. It's not cancer. It's not heart disease. It's losing their mind, losing their brain and nervous system health and gut health. That is at the foundation of real health. And that is, we're actually going to be talking about that at our next webinar, is focused on gut health. We're going to talk about that tonight too, but we're just going to try to skim and scratch the surface because the next webinar, we're going to be going into gut health in detail. That's what it's on. That's on Tuesday, October 4th. The next line up though are your stressors, physical stress, chemical toxic stress, mental and emotional stress. So your body does not tell the difference between one stress and another. Stress is stress is stress. So sitting at a desk job is the same way as having you know, dangerous or emotionally stressful relationship, is the same way as having, you know, living in a moldy home or having, you know, silver fillings or using, you know, the standard American diet or drinking tap water. You know, all those stresses are the exact same thing. So you have to address those next. Then when we find a little bit more about the cause, then we, you know, look at specific organ systems like the endocrine system, like the immune system, like the digestive system. We use physician grade supplements to work with those things. And then the last step, the tip of the pyramid, is functional lab testing, because that's, you know, the last step. Not everybody needs that for real health. But we're really excited about this. You'll see a couple other things in today's PowerPoint with this website on there. It's not live yet, but it's being built right now, the Real Health Resource. So thyroid stats, so, you know, why is thyroid a problem? Why are we hosting this webinar? And I'll say too that, you know, this is our second webinar. So if you didn't, if you weren't able to tune into the last one, it was on autoimmune disease. And I'll give you the link at the end to where you can actually watch the replay of that. But, you know, we picked these first three topics: gut health, autoimmune disease, and thyroid disease, because those three topics are epidemic in our society. And also, well, people, you know, there's an educational component to them. You know, people need to know how these things happen, how they work. But also, all three of those issues, there really isn't a good solution in the medical system. They, first off, you know, don't get to the root cause of the problem. They treat it with the wrong things. They treat it with medications. They treat things with, you know, antibiotics. The thyroid, they treat with, you know, Synthroid or levothyroxine, synthetic thyroid hormones, instead of actually looking for the root cause. And autoimmune conditions are the same thing. Gut health issues are the same thing. And really, the three of those are they're not three different things, really. They're one in the same. So that's why we picked those three topics. The other thing that I want to mention is what we're going to be talking about tonight is not necessarily, you know, like, there's a lot about thyroid. Not going to be thyroid cancer, not going to be nodules, not going to be goiters. There's just a ton of information out there. We're going to be talking about what most people are dealing with, and that is hypo or hyperthyroidism and the autoimmune conditions that are associated with that. And, you know, this started because when I first started my practice, you know, now I've done intakes and patient histories on over 1,000 patients. And most are presenting with, you know, musculoskeletal complaints in a chiropractic clinic. But when we start digging into their real health history, we find that they're on things like Synthroid and say, well, when did that start? Well, you know, I just went into my doctor, I was feeling tired, or I was cold, or I was warm, or whatever symptom. And they did a lab test. The lab test came back, and they just said, take this and take it for the rest of your life. Okay, and that's what's happening out there. So thyroid cancer, is that a big deal? Absolutely. But that's not what today's webinar is going to be about. So let's get into these stats. What are we seeing here? So, you know, it's an estimated, this is a loose estimation, 30 million Americans have thyroid dysfunction. I've seen, you know, it's over 20 that are confirmed, 40 I've definitely seen thrown out there. You know, same with autoimmune and same with gut health issues. They don't know for sure because it's hard to say. And like you see below there, up to 60% of people are unaware of their condition. Okay. And this is from, you know, a medical website. The causes of thyroid problems are largely unknown. I would 100% disagree with that. We know what causes thyroid problems. It's the same things that cause a lot of other problems. It's our diet, it's our toxins, it's our stress, it's our lifestyle. But the problem is that we don't address those causes because it can't be addressed with, you know, patented chemicals. Undiagnosed thyroid disease may put patients at risk for certain serious conditions like heart disease, like osteoporosis, like infertility. The thyroid's really, really important for all the other hormones. Okay, so infertility or reproductive issues oftentimes have a thyroid component. Osteoporosis oftentimes have a thyroid component. And what I'd say too with these stats is that most chronic diseases honestly have a thyroid component. So that's why it's so important, is because, you know, it's happening in all these diseases that are ending our life, like cardiovascular disease or you know, diabetes. But the thyroid part isn't mentioned in that. Oh, they died of diabetes. Well, they also had thyroid problems and it played a role. Well, they died of heart disease. Well, they also could have had thyroid problems, and it absolutely played a role. So when you look at men versus women, what's the difference? Women are 5 to 8 times more likely than men to have thyroid problems. And I would absolutely confirm that, you know, just based on my clinical experience, that it's pretty rare, you know, to see a man with thyroid condition. 1 in 8 women will develop a thyroid disorder during her lifetime. And it's important for everything, you know, hormonally, but think about especially, you know, growing child, a baby. Pregnant women with undiagnosed or inadequately treated hypothyroidism have an increased risk of miscarriage, preterm delivery, and severe developmental problems in their children. Okay, so it's happening way more frequently in women, and it affects them considerably more because their hormones are a lot more delicate. They have to do really, really important things like bear children, and it can cause massive disruptions there. So it's really, really important to know how your thyroid is functioning. So, you know, what does it look like if you have a problem? Well, like I said, we're going to talk about hyper and hypo, Hashimoto's, Graves' disease as the bulk of this webinar. But hyper, okay, so, you know, you think of a hyper person. Hyper means that the thyroid is working too much. Okay, so when they talk about hyperthyroidism, the thyroid is secreting too much thyroid hormone. So what does thyroid hormone do? It's like metabolism juice. Okay, so when you're moving, you're burning fat, you're jittery, you're restless, you have energy, you know, and when you think about normal should be good sleep, good energy, you know, normal concentration, proper weight, you know, that's kind of normal or optimal. So hyper is on the one side of the spectrum where you're going too fast. You feel like you can't fall asleep. You feel like you can't sit still. You feel like you can't put on weight. You feel like you can't concentrate. Hypo, which is more common, hypo is more like you're sluggish. You're dragging. You have lethargy. You have fatigue. You've gained weight unexplainably, or you're not able to lose weight the way that you used to be able to. Or a lot of times, you know, we'll see, you know, maybe somebody, they lose 10 pounds and then they can't lose anymore. Even though they have 50 more pounds to lose, they hit a plateau. Well, that's your thyroid. Rough skin, rough hair, even a rough voice, a coarse voice. Your hair falling out. So beginning to notice, you know, hair falling out in the showers, a big red flag thyroid symptom. And, you know, cold body temperature. And with hyper, it would be the opposite. Warm body temperature because your thyroid regulates heat. Okay, and so speaking of regulating heat, that's a good time to transition into, you know, my next analogy that I want to explain, because if you can understand this analogy, it's going to make a big difference with what we're about to get into with the thyroid function. Okay, so the analogy is the air conditioner, or excuse me, rather the thermostat. Because I don't want to say the air conditioner. So I want to paint this picture of how a thermostat works. We all know what they look like. We all know, you know, generally how they work. You know, you push the button and it works. But think about the concept here. So for a thermostat to work, the first thing that it has to have is a sensor. Okay, so the sensor is going to tell the thermostat what the current environment is. Okay, so let's say I set my thermostat to 72, comfortable 72 degrees. Well, that sensor is going to tell the thermostat whether it's at 32. The sensor is a thermometer. Okay, so the thermometer is gonna say, let's say it's cold, it's night, tonight maybe. The sensor might say, okay, we are at 68 degrees, right? So then the sensor sends a signal to the thermostat, says we're at 68. Thermostat says, uh-oh, we're supposed to be at 72. I got to kick on the furnace. So then the thermostat sends another signal over here to the furnace, kicks on the furnace. Furnace produces heat. As the heat rises, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72. Sensor says 72, send a signal back to thermostat. Thermostat stops. right? Sends a signal to the furnace, actually. Furnace stop. So you walk up and you touch a button on your wall, and all these things happen. And this is very similar to your thyroid, is that the function, there's a lot of different steps. So if your heat, your HVAC, you know, is broken, how many times is somebody going to come in and say, oh, you need a new furnace, you need a new air conditioning unit? Well, that's thousands of dollars. Why don't we look to see where it's broken at? Why don't we look for the cause? You know, the other side of the spectrum is maybe in the summer, sensor says, hey, it's 74. We're set at 72. Signal to thermostat, signal from a thermostat to air conditioner kicks on to keep it at 72. And your body is the exact same way. When it's hot, we sweat. When it's cold, we shiver. Your body works the exact same way. It senses the environment. It sends signals into the computer, your brain, via the nervous system. The brain and the nervous system send signals back out to the mechanisms, the body, to bring things back into regulation, homeostasis, or balance. If you can grasp that concept, you now understand exactly how the thyroid works, and you also understand why it is so important to get the proper testing and the proper treatment. And in a second here, you're going to understand why the medical system is completely inadequate at painting really finding the cause and really treating the underlying problems. And I don't like the word treat, but, you know, removing out the interference. What's interfering with the body's natural ability to be healthy? So I hope that you understand that analogy. I'm going to show you some pictures that will tie it together, exactly how that analogy works with your body. So every single cell in your body has receptors for the thyroid hormone. And remember this later, because that is the key, the receptors. If your body is producing a lot, like, let's go back to the example. Say your thermostat is producing the signal saying, hey, you know, we're too cold. It's 68. We're set at 72. Signal, 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 signal. But nothing's happening at the furnace. Well, maybe the furnace is broken. Maybe the connection is broken. Maybe the signal is broken. But the answer is not get a new furnace, first step. Okay, and that's what we're going to look at. But that receptor is exactly how that works. So remember that, the receptors. Thyroid hormones regulate important things like metabolism, energy, weight loss or weight gain, fat burning specifically. They're necessary for growth and development in our children. Okay, so a child with a, you know, imbalanced thyroid is going to have issues. Thyroid dysfunction is associated with so many disease processes because it's necessary for nearly every process in your body. That's why this stuff is so important. So how does this thing work? Well, here's a picture. Okay, this is the picture of the thyroid pathways, the production. So I'm gonna show you this on this zoomed out version, then you'll see I'll go into a zoomed in version and go a little more detailed. But your hypothalamus is something that's in your brain. Okay, and it's something that, I was looking to see if I have a laser pointer. I think I do. But the hypothalamus, that's your sensor. Okay, the hypothalamus and the pituitary together, they're your sensor thermostat combination. Okay, so the hypothalamus receives signals saying, hey, we're too hot, we're too cold. We don't have enough energy. We have too much energy. We're burning too much fat. We're not burning enough fat. Whatever's going on in the environment, the hypothalamus is going to receive that. It sends a signal to what's called the pituitary, which also sits in the brain. That is, you know, your body's master control tower for all of your hormones. So hypothalamus and pituitary, control tower for all your hormones. And we're going to talk about that at the end, you know, how that can be affected. But then from here down is really where we start to get into, you know, the things that people, you know, begin to understand and recognize. So TSH, you might recognize those three letters. The pituitary sends signals to the thyroid via this hormone called TSH. It's called thyroid stimulating hormone. Okay, and it does exactly that. It stimulates the thyroid. So the idea is in the medical treatment is that if your body's producing too much TSH, you're out of the normal range of TSH. The only reason why is because your thyroid's not working properly. So that's how they diagnose hypothyroidism. So let's look at a zoomed in version here so you get the upper part. So the hypothalamus receives signals. Okay, it sends those signals. It's like the sensor. It sends the signals back to the thermostat. Okay, pituitary is the thermostat. The thermostat sends signals to either the furnace or the air conditioner, in this case the furnace, and signals to the thyroid saying, hey, kick on, we're not where we need to be. So that makes sense that if they're, you know, if the thyroid's not working properly, the body would produce more TSH. But we're about to get into the other moving parts in this process that are just as important. So once the TSH goes to the thyroid gland, says, hey, furnace, kick up the heat. So the thyroid starts producing its glands, or its hormone, excuse me. So it produces thyroid hormone. Okay, and when we hear thyroid hormone, we always hear it as thyroid hormones. It's not just one. So, and I'm actually going to explain and break down what each of these means in a really, you know, elementary explanation here. So the thyroid secretes what's called T4. Okay, T4 is the inactive version of thyroid hormone, meaning it does nothing. Okay, so if you look down here at this little nub off the end here, and you look at your body's cells, you see if that nub was a key and that goalpost on that cell was a lock, that key is not going into that lock, right? It never will. So T4 is actually inactive. So your thyroid secretes about 90% inactive hormone that can't be used. 10% of that hormone is T3 and can be used, but that's pretty obsolete because 90% of it is all your T4. Okay, so then T4 has to be turned into T3 because T3 is the active version. So that happens, if you look at these pictures, via the liver. The liver does 80% of this conversion. So T4 to convert to T3, the liver has to be working properly. And then the other one there is the gut. So the gut does the other 20%. So right away, if you've got a bad gut, you've got dysbiosis, you have a leaky gut, this is why you need to tune into our next webinar next month. Right away, a bad gut, you're losing 20% of your body's ability to convert thyroid hormones. Okay, so that's crazy. But so T4 gets converted to T3. T3 is then what can get into the cell. Okay, so that's really, really, really important because most people with a thyroid condition, and here's the problem, you know, with medical treatment, and this is not my opinion, this is the standard of medical care. Hypothyroidism is often diagnosed only by a high TSH test. So if we go back to this whole big picture, you know, this is a intricate process. Just because TSH is high does not mean that the thyroid is not producing enough hormone. Sometimes it is. We could have a problem in the liver. We could have a problem in the gut. There's other issues. Okay, so they will only test TSH. And a lot of times they will call that Hashimoto's disease. Okay, so Hashimoto's disease, for those that aren't familiar, Hashimoto's disease is autoimmune hypothyroidism. Okay, so, you know, if you missed our last webinar, we talked about Hashimoto's and saying that it's treated with Synthroid or levothyroxine the same way that any hypothyroidism, you know, they say that if the thyroid's not making enough thyroid hormone, then we need to give the body thyroid hormone. Well, Hashimoto's is not a problem of the thyroid. It's autoimmune. The immune is attacking the thyroid gland. That's what's causing the thyroid problem. That's the definition of autoimmune disease. And we talked about that last webinar. So it makes absolutely no sense to treat Hashimoto's thyroiditis with a synthetic thyroid hormone. It's absolutely doing nothing. It's going to get your TSH lab number into the normal range, which is what your doctor wants. That's what they treat. Remember, they're not trying to correct things. I mean, that's they would love for you to get well. I'm not saying that. It's not about them personally, but that's not their job. If you come in with a TSH level out of the normal range, the medical doctor's job is to get your TSH level into the normal range. It's not to find out the underlying causes. It's not to measure the other things. It's standard of care. Okay. And there's problems with that. So going back to the slides here, that is the standard of care. And with Hashimoto's especially, it's horrible because they won't ever really confirm Hashimoto's. You'd have to get a really, really good doctor in the medical insurance system to do this because they won't get reimbursed on it because there is no standard of care to treat Hashimoto's. They only treat hypothyroidism. Even though 80% of hypothyroidism is known to be Hashimoto's, there is no standard of care. The medical system has no answers for autoimmune conditions and things like Hashimoto's or Graves' disease. And once again, that's not my opinion. That's just a fact today that it's not part of the standard of care. That's why functional medicine doctors, you know, people like myself that specialize in more of the body's function are becoming, you know, really, really popular because that's the only way that you're going to get to the root cause. So anyway, off my soapbox there. But then they treat it with medications to get TSH into the normal range, Synthroid, levothyroxine, those are synthetic T4s. Armor, Nature Thyroid, you know, some synthetic T4, T3 blends. But here's the thing. They never check. They'll sometimes check T4, and that's it. They'll never check T3. They never check free T3. They never check what's called RT3, which is over here, you know. So when T4 converts to T3, if the T3 is free, that means it hasn't gotten into the cell. Or if it's reverse T3, that's something that we'll talk about later. And they never confirm Hashimoto's by testing the thyroid antibodies. That's the only way that you can confirm Hashimoto's is to prove that the immune system is actually attacking against it. So, you know, it's very, very complex and complicated, but it's also mistreated. Here is, let's see if I can pull this off. So we have some labs here that I might be able to show you. Let me see if I can just. Sorry, these worked fine last time, and I think that I can get this figured out actually pretty quickly. If it doesn't happen within the next few seconds, I won't waste anybody's time. But I think that I can pull these up and, oh no. So we went through a lot of lab tests last time and showed some examples of normal lab tests, abnormal lab tests, and for some reason the picture is just distorting here. But I still think, like I said, that I can get these up here. Because these are important. So if you can see these, okay, thank you for being patient. This is going to be a little bit different because you can probably see my side slides here too. But, you know, zoom in if you need to, but I want to point these out. So here's a couple normal lab tests, okay? So I'm going to go through these numbers, and over on the right is the normal range. And then there's the, on the left is the name of the test. So TSH, okay, so that's thyroid stimulating hormone. So you see the range is between 0.45 and 4.5. And I'll talk about that range in a second. But so this top one, their TSH is 1.64. Okay, so right in the middle of that range, perfectly normal according to that range. The next one down is T4. So that's thyroid hormone. It's at 5.2. So once again, you know, if you look at the range there, it's on the low end, but it's right within that range, so completely normal. So the thyroid is secreting a low amount of hormone, but within the normal amount. Then the T3 uptake is right in the middle and is actually pretty high, you know, towards the higher end. So that's really, really good. So the cells are uptaking plenty of active hormone. Okay, and I'll go back to the picture in a minute, but I wanted you guys to be able to see these slides. And then T4, the free T4 is pretty low. So there's not a lot of T4 floating around. The T3 is getting into the cells. The fact that T4 is a little bit low means nothing. That's actually good. You don't want your thyroid to be secreting a ton of thyroid hormone. You want your body to be what's called hormone sensitive, which means that if I secrete a little bit, it can go a long way. You want your car to be gas sensitive, right? You want it to be fuel sensitive. You want it to be fuel efficient. Same thing with your hormones. You want it to be sensitive. So now let's compare that to the one below. Once again, normal values. But first thing you'll see is that TSH is lower. It's definitely lower. Then you'll see that the thyroxine, the T4, is actually a lot higher. So those two would make sense. The thyroid is producing more hormone. So the body is telling the thyroid, hey, you don't need to produce as much. Just like if the furnace is producing a lot of heat, the sensor is going to say, hey, you don't need to produce as much heat. We're staying at 72 pretty comfortably. Now, the T3 uptake on this person is a lot lower than the person above here. Okay, so that means that not as much T3 is getting into the cells. Okay, so that's a concern. And then T4 that's free, there's more free T4. Okay, so that is, that's, you know, a couple normal lab tests there, but still some really interesting findings. Okay, now the next one that I'll show you, I'm gonna pull up here, and this one I said normal question mark. Okay, so normal question mark, because none of these, if they were high or low, it would have an H or an L next to them. So they are within the normal range here. But let's look at this. So TSH, this first one, 4.23. Okay, that's 315% higher those previous two slides. But it's still within the normal range, but that's high. So now's the time to talk about normal ranges and what is a normal range. This is the LabCorp normal range. Okay, so LabCorp normal range is just based on the people that came in and got tested within the last year. Where did most of them fall? Well, most people that do lab testing are sick, but also that's the normal range. There's what's called a functional range. The functional range is actually what, you know, practitioners like, you know, myself and functional medicine practitioners, that's what we actually look at is, okay, here's this huge, huge range. Where do we really want to be? What's really ideal? And the functional range for TSH, the high end is 3. Okay, so now let's go back to this and look at that, where their functional TSH is, 4.23. So it's definitely above that functional range. The T4, the next one down, 8.3. So, you know, it's right in the middle of that range, but if you compare it to the two slides before, it's considerably higher. You know, 7.5 was the high end, this one's 8.3. The T3 uptake is lower, okay? So that is at the low end of the range there. T3 uptake is all the way at the bottom. So not as much T3 is getting into the cells. And then T4, the free T4, that is actually fairly normal. So what that makes me think, what that leads me to believe with this patient is that T4 is not the problem. Really, the thyroid itself isn't really the problem. It's some of these other issues. And let me just pull up the broken slides. And yeah, so we can't see those. But yeah, so the T3 uptake is on the low end. So let's look at this again. So TSH is on the high end. So up here, we're secreting a lot of TSH saying, hey, thyroid, hey, furnace, we need more heat. We need more heat. We need more heat. So the T4 is relatively high. So the furnace is making heat. So the furnace is like, hey, why are you telling me to make more heat? I'm making a lot. I'm actually making too much heat. You must have a window open. You must have, you know, your front door wide open or something. I'm making thyroid hormone here. So then the free T4 was fairly normal. Okay, so there's T4, it's making T4, but then the free T4 is fairly normal. So that makes me believe that T4 is being converted to T3 pretty well. You know, if we had a ton of free T4, it's not being converted. It should turn to T3, but it's not free. There's not a lot of free. So the liver and the gut, they're doing their job. They're making it into T3. But then the T3 uptake is on the low end. So this is a perfect example of somebody that really their thyroid is producing T4. And really their liver and their gut is converting T4 to T3. This person has the typical classic inflammation-induced hormone sensitivity issues, hormone blunting, okay? And so hormone resistance is the word I was looking for there. So when this cell membrane around the cell becomes inflamed and creates inflammation, it blunts and blocks those receptors. So remember when I said that these receptors were going to be really important. So if you see on the T3, there's a little upside down cross hanging off the end there. And then on the cell, there's that goalpost. Okay. And that cross and that goalpost, you see they go together like a hand and a glove, like a key and a lock, right? And that's exactly how it works, is that key has to fit into that lock to unlock all the things that are happening inside your body. Well, here's a prank that we used to pull when we were kids. I should have maybe said that, admitted that out loud, but what if somebody put super glue in your keyhole? It's a horrible prank. It messes up a lot of things. It messes up somebody's life, really. But what if somebody put super glue in your keyhole? That key is not going in no matter what. That's what inflammation does, you guys. That's why it's so critically important. That is what inflammation does. Close this. That's what inflammation does, is it actually puts glue in the lock so that the key can't get in, so the T3 can't get into the cells. So when we look at this lab test and T3 uptake is on the low end, and you're talking about you've been diagnosed with a thyroid condition, you've taken the thyroid medication for years, and you don't even know if your hormones are able to get into your cells, that's bananas to me. That's you know, you're just not getting to the cause ever. You're really just covering up the symptom and getting a good lab test, and your doctor will say your TSH is normal, come back in 6 months and let's tweak the dosage. Okay, so with that being said, what everybody should want to know, everyone should know their TSH, everyone should know their T4. Those are the two basics that they'll typically do, you know, even if you went to your GP, they'll do those. T3 uptake, really, really important. And I'd say that might be the most important, because how is that hormone getting into the cell? And then free T4. And I think that's really important too, because, you know, like I said, a lot of times it's not the thyroid's problem, it's the liver and it's the gut. So is it the thyroid? Is it the liver? Is it the gut? Is it the cells? You need to know those four things to know that. Now, if you have a known thyroid condition, what you need to know are a few other things. Free T3. So is that T3 getting into the cells, you know, or is the that's kind of like T3 uptake. RT3. So there's another thing called reverse T3. We'll talk about that in a little bit when we get into our action steps. But reverse T3, if there's one thing that you notice on that, is that it has the same key. Okay, so if somebody else has your key, they can get inside your home, they can lock it from the inside, or they change the locks, you can't get in. That's what RT3 is, and we're gonna talk about that. But you wanna know that, and you want to know the autoimmune antibodies, TPO and ATA. That proves that your immune system, that's what confirms, that's the only thing that can confirm Hashimoto's or Graves. So if you've been told that you have Hashimoto's or Graves and you have not had these tests, you've been, not lied to, I don't want to say they're a liar, but you've been misguided. They don't know for sure unless you've had these tests. And selenium, really, really, really important test, you know, sometimes even a 24-hour iodine test, because those are really important cofactors for the thyroid. So lab prices. This is a special that we did the other night, but you know, I left this in here because we gave 7 days on this. So we've already had a lot of people take advantage of this. So there's what's called an everyone panel. So that's like, you know, I said everyone should know TSH, T4, free T4. Okay, so the everyone panel, and I have it right here in front of me. So I'll read what all is on an everyone panel, because it's not it isn't a thyroid panel. It's really an inflammation panel. So I'm just going to skim through this. It has serum glucose. It has HbA1c, one of the most important inflammatory markers. Also, you know, it's a blood sugar marker, but it's also an aging marker. Okay, so that's glycation, or aging is really, you know, wrinkles in your skin are glycation sped up by sugar. That's why HbA1c is an important measure for diabetics. Then it has all your serum. I guess these would be like minerals and things. So there's potassium, sodium, you know, carbon dioxide, calcium, phosphorus, you know, all your serum levels. There are probably 20 things here. Liver enzymes are in here. Here's serum iron. Here's serum ferritin, both very, very important. Vitamin D. So the 25-hydroxy vitamin D is on here. Then also your cholesterol, your lipids, and not just your lipids, but a really specific breakdown, what's called an NMR, which is a lipid profile that breaks down your lipids, your HDL, your LDL, into their specific, even smaller parts, like what, like LDL-C, HDL-C, LDL-P. So there's little different particles that make up HDL and LDL that are really important to know, you know, just how inflamed your body is. But then there's the thyroid TSH, thyroxine, T3 uptake, T4 free, that's on there. Insulin, serum insulin is also on here, really important, even for non-diabetic, for anything. A CBC, which is a complete blood count, is on here. Then there's the NMR, then there's, there is also insulin resistance. So this is a really, really informative lab panel here that tells you a ton of answers for how inflamed your body is. And you know, everybody always wants to nickel and dime lab prices because they can get their insurance to cover a lot of labs. But I just told you why that's not a good solution. You know, if you go to the doctor and you try to get the insurance to cover, you can find out TSH, you might be able to find out T4. You're gonna have a hard time finding these other values and really getting to the cause. So when somebody really wants to know how to be healthy, how to take their health to the next level, whether it's, you know, a mom or a professional athlete, you really can get some important values through some of these lab tests, but you have to have the value there, the financial value, to pay out of pocket for these. The full thyroid panel is normally $350. For tonight's webinar, it is $300. And I'll note, nobody's bought the everyone panel, you know, after this webinar. Everyone's wanted to know all the answers. They bought the full thyroid panel. So you see that each of those are $50 off. They're normally $250 and $350 tonight, and for the next 7 days, if you read below there, they're $200 and $300. So all you have to do is use the contact form or send an email to frontdesk@wealignutah.com within the next week. Okay, so like yesterday, for example, a couple people called, and they paid over the phone, we printed them a requisition, they came by that day and got the requisition, and they probably went to LabCorp, you know, and got their blood work done this morning. Okay, so it's quick and it's easy, but that's what you gotta do. Okay, so now we're going to get into, you know, what I would consider, you know, the meat and potatoes of the talk. Actually, with this one talk, that what we just covered really was the meat and potatoes, because if you understand the function, the rest is downstream. If you've been diagnosed with, you know, and you have to have the labs, because otherwise the function doesn't really make sense, because the labs is what is the only thing that can tell you which area is broken. Otherwise, you can do these five action steps without any labs. These action steps are for anybody. They're not for somebody just with a diagnosed thyroid condition. They're really for anybody. And what we look at, you know, when we go back to that real health pyramid and just kind of, you know, the philosophy of our office, we're not a medical office. We're not a functional medical office, because a functional medical office is a medical office that looks a little bit deeper and maybe sometimes uses natural things, it's still treating symptoms. You have this symptom, take this supplement. And you know, we give supplements for sure, but we look at it from a completely different philosophy. We look at it from the philosophy that God designed your body to be healthy. So if it's not, why? Okay, and that's really it. We look at why, and so that's function. But then we look at removing the interferences, because your body innately should be expressing full health. So when we talk about diet, we talk about exercise, we're not using these things as treatments. We're using them to support your body's natural ability to be healthy, because it really should be healthy and energetic and vibrant. And if it's not, then something caused that. And that's what we do, is we help look for that. So we're going to get into the action steps. What can we actually do here? So we're going to do 5 crucial steps for a healthy thyroid function. Okay, and here they are. Spoiler alert: eating a real food diet, maintaining a healthy gut, managing stress, proper cellular detoxification, and taking the right supplements. And you know, these could be my 5 crucial steps for anything. And that's the thing, is this isn't specific for thyroid. You know, some of these things are, but this is going to be also, this is going to support, you know, other autoimmune conditions. This is going to support other hormone conditions. It's really getting to the root cause, and the root cause can cause lots of different variations, but the solution is the same. So number one, eating a real food diet. And with thyroid, you know, I'm not going to be talking about the ketogenic diet, which I absolutely love. I'm not going to be talking about a paleo diet, really, even though a real food diet, I guess, is a paleo diet. But, you know, it's not necessarily about the diet that you follow. It's just about this one concept that we harp on so much, is eat real food. Eat foods by God, don't eat foods by man. If you eat foods by God and stop eating foods by man, I mean, that's 90% of the health battle. You know, and if you start that from youth, you know, like we're trying to do with our girls, you start that from a young age, they're never going to have any of these conditions. It really, truly does start with food. I don't think that food's, you know, the most important thing, because, you know, the cells, healing is really important. The nervous system is incredibly important. Those two things control everything else, the gut too, but it starts with food, because food affects all those things. Food affects your cells, it affects your hormones, it causes a leaky gut, it causes brain fog, it causes weight gain, inflammation, the root of all of our disease processes. So it has to start with food. It has to start with a non-GMO, healthy, organic diet. Okay. And so when I say non-GMO, you know, food by God and food by man, it's genetically modified. God made it this way. We made it this way. It is the exact opposite of a food by God. Okay. So let's pull this slide back up. So what does that look like? You know, we have a lot of resources, you know, available. Okay. So for this, so I'm not getting into, hey, you know, you need to eat a smoothie in the morning and a salad for lunch and the salmon for dinner. There's a ton of resources on what foods to eat. Check out the Real Health blog. We've got so many great articles on inflammation and sugar. Check out the Real Health podcast. Tons and tons of great episodes. Episode number 1 is called The Total Food Makeover. That's a really good one. There's episodes on sugars, episodes on fats 2.0, on proteins, on the basics of the paleo diet, on inflammation, on sugar, on all these topics. So that's not what tonight's webinar is about, telling you what foods to eat, just telling you that you need to eat food, real food, and avoid fake food. And right away, you know, you're starting off pretty good. So what we teach also, though, is called a plant-based paleo diet. Okay, so paleo does mean the foods that you're genetically designed to be able to use and eat, but ours is plant-based. So anyway, you tune into those things or check out those things, check out the podcast, check out the blog to find out what that means if you're unfamiliar. But here's a couple foods specifically that actually do support thyroid function. Okay, so Brazil nuts, really, really high in selenium, really, really good thing. And seaweed, or you know, things like nori or kelp, even kelp or yeah, seaweeds. Those are really, really high in iodine. Okay, and so I remember I mentioned selenium and iodine, really, really important. In fact, essential for the thyroid to work. Some other things are like your good meats, your free range eggs, your wild caught salmon have a lot of good healthy fats in them and good healthy fat balance that actually helps support your endocrine system in general, but support your thyroids and create, you know, healthy hormones. Some other things are foods that support a healthy gut and liver. So I just said fibrous vegetables because fiber is the number one thing to help the gut and the liver. You know, so fiber actually goes through your gut, cleans it out, but as it's going through it, the liver produces bile, and the fiber binds that bile and gets toxins out of your system. So fiber is really, really important. So a good example of that is, you know, like asparagus is a great one. Or probably the best example for this application is cruciferous vegetables, which are like broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cauliflower. Those are really, really good to support your liver. So remember, your liver does 80% of your T4 to T3 conversion. So you want to support your liver. I actually think that I have a podcast episode that is top 10 foods to naturally boost detox. That'd be a great resource to go back and look at. We talk about how all these foods support the liver, support the gut, support the kidneys, and support healthy detox. Special focus with that, you know, because food by God and food by man, you know, that can be confusing when you think, well, you know, gluten, bread, you know, there's a lot, there are some foods by God that you might think, hey, this is a food by God, this is a natural food, but, you know, it might not be. So gluten and soy are probably the two biggest. Gluten, soy, and dairy are the three biggest food allergens that there are. But gluten and soy are specifically problematic for the thyroid. So soy has what's called phytoestrogens, which are estrogen mimicking compounds. So soy is actually, you know, pretty dangerous for hormonal health. And what I would say is that, you know, I tell everybody avoid soy, men and women, because 90% of our soy is genetically modified and it's in everything. Oh my gosh, you start flipping over your labels, you start looking for soybean oil, you're gonna know it really quick. It's in everything because, you know, we're gonna talk about, you know, soy and gluten, but let's add the third one in corn. The reason that those are in everything, they're subsidized by our government and they put them in everything and they're all GMO. So, you know, your high fructose corn syrup, your wheat is in everything. Soy is in everything. So you got to avoid those. So soy is really dangerous. The number one culprit, though, of this is gluten. And, you know, I had a patient in just the other day and he said, hey, you know, I'm trying this gluten-free diet. I said, okay, awesome. How are you feeling? He said, it's crazy. I feel a huge difference already. And, you know, we're thinking, well, that's not crazy. That's what we expect. But he said the craziest thing really is how much stuff it's in. I said, oh, yeah. You start reading the food labels and he's been blown away now that he's aware how much stuff it's in. So when you look at gluten, the problem is that gluten molecules actually closely resemble thyroid molecules. Okay, so the problem with gluten, you know, we're going back to the basics of our autoimmune webinar last time, is that if gluten from your wheat gets across a leaky gut, gets into the body, then the immune system mounts an attack on it. And that is an autoimmune condition. And oftentimes gluten is the entryway to other autoimmune conditions. Gluten is the number one culprit for this. But the immune system starts to attack it. So say your immune system has started attacking gluten. You know, there's celiac disease. That's like 1% of the population, though, I think. 20% of the population has diagnosed non-celiac gluten sensitivity. Actually, I think celiac is like maybe 3%, but it's low. But it's estimated that 80% of the population really has some form of reaction to gluten or some form of gluten intolerance. So anyway, your immune system mounts an attack on that. Well, what happens is if it finds a something that looks like gluten, it's going to attack it because it's confused and it says, hey, this looks like gluten. This is not good. We're going to attack it. If you go back to our last webinar, to the autoimmune webinar, we had an awesome slide in there that came from Cyrex Laboratories, the lab that we use, the leader in autoimmune lab testing. And it talks about this. It talks about how, you know, wheat has changed and how now because of the Roundup and the things that are sprayed on the wheat, your body doesn't recognize it the same and actually begins to mount an attack on it. So the attack starts on wheat, on gluten, but then the attack moves over to thyroid tissue because gluten molecules closely resemble thyroid tissue. So there's a lot of things in our diet that can, or in our lifestyle, I should say, that can affect thyroid function, gluten being the biggest one. And, you know, here are a couple others and that we're going to get into right now, but like iodine deficiency, stress, fluoride is another big one. Bromines are another really, really big one. And we'll talk about that when we talk about, you know, toxins. But all these things attack the thyroid, and gluten is a huge one. So number two is, I'm missing some muscle. So is a healthy gut. Okay, so your gut bacteria, remember we said that that plays 20% of the role of the thyroid hormone conversion. But like we were just talking about with gluten, a leaky gut is what allows gluten into the body in the first place. So if you never have a leaky gut, then you never have a problem with gluten, then you never have a problem with Hashimoto's or Graves. So healing the gut, that's where it starts. And one of the crazy things with gut health is that this is so important from the very beginning. We've heard so many sad stories recently of people who were feeding their kids, you know, crap foods, basically, you know, the standard American diet. And what do they get? You know, they get sick. You know, they get sick as an infant. You know, you feed them infant formula, standard infant formula, they're going to get sick. They're going to get food allergies. And you're going to think, oh, my kid just has ear infections and they just wet the bed. And that's sickness, okay? That was me when I was a kid. Ear infections, tubes in, wet the bed, ADHD, you know, surgeries, medications. That is sickness and disease. And if it's not addressed, it's going to become a bigger issue. And it starts in the gut, okay? So a healthy gut. So your gut bacteria, or what's called your microbiome, plays an incredibly important role in everything in your body, but specifically into thyroid metabolism. So like I just said, you know, leaky gut is the entryway to something like Hashimoto's. Hashimoto's, I don't want to say it would never happen, but you know, it's pretty safe to say that most autoimmune diseases like Hashimoto's would never happen without the aspect of a leaky gut. Gut inflammation, when the gut is chronically inflamed, like most people's gut is inflamed, it actually raises cortisol, which is a stress hormone. And that affects thyroid metabolism. All your hormones work together really well. We're going to talk about stress actually next, number three, action step. But when you're stressed, all those hormones interact, and so it's going to affect thyroid metabolism. Dysbiosis, which you're going to hear a lot about on October 4th, Tuesday, October 4th at the Gut Health webinar. Dysbiosis affects T4 to T3 conversion because those bacteria are what do the conversion. So you have to make sure that you're maintaining a healthy gut. I'm not going to give any action steps on how to maintain a healthy gut because you have to tune in to the Gut Health webinar. But this is so incredibly important for everybody in your family. It's crazy how many people we've seen have such dramatic, amazing results by just focusing on their gut health and, of course, their spine health, their nervous system health. Okay, number three, managing stress. So we all know that stress is killing us, but we might not know, you know, how that happens biologically. So stress isn't just a feeling. Stress is a response, and it's a response in your body that can be measured, and it's a hormone response. So remember your hypothalamus, your pituitary, your thyroid, and your adrenal glands are all intimately connected. Stress is kind of like maybe, you know, always keeping the windows and doors open when in the middle of winter or the middle of summer. it's like, you know, the thyroid is working to try to keep that temperature regulated. The sensor, the hypothalamus, the pituitary, the thermostat, they're all working, trying to keep it regulated, and it doesn't matter. Okay, so this summer is a great example. This has been such a hot summer. This summer, if my you know, heat was set at 72, it didn't matter. You know, it was so stinking hot that it did not matter. It could not get to 72. And so our bills were astronomical because the air conditioner would just keep going. And so what happens to that piece of machinery? It eventually wears out or malfunctions. And that's exactly what chronic stress does. The thing about chronic stress that I think is probably the least understood is that all forms of stress cause the same stress response. Okay, they raise cortisol. So when I talk about stress, you know, stress is stress, and it's just a hormonal response, but that's physical stress. Okay, sitting at a desk is a stress. Okay, having an old sports injury that never properly healed, that's a stress. That's a physical stress. Your body secretes stress hormones in response to those things. Chemical, you know, you could be exercising and eating well, and if you got, you know, something like silver amalgam fillings, or you lay on a, you know, bed that's sprayed with flame retardants, or you know, you drink tap water, or you live in Utah, you know, if you're toxic, that is a stress, and it creates a stress response. It creates inflammation in the cells. That's proven. We know that. And it creates hormone resistance with the cell membrane, like we talked about, and it's a vicious cycle. And then, you know, thirdly, this is the one that we know about, that we think about, that we talk about, and that is mental or emotional stress. Okay, so that's like, you know, your relationships, your bills, your happiness with your life, your spirituality, you know, what you do to relax and unwind. And that's just something that, you know, gosh, look at our society today. Look at all three of those things. So physical stress. Do we work more desk jobs than we ever did? Absolutely. Sitting is the new smoking. The reason that they say that is because they're now able to actually see and measure that it is just as harmful for a person as smoking to work a desk job. That's our society. Do we have toxins in our society? Ugh, you're talking to the wrong person. Don't get me started. Yes, we have toxins in our society everywhere. And do we have mental and emotional stress? We have a negative savings rate. We have a majority divorce rate. We have so much of all three of the stressors that your body can't handle it. Okay, and so what happens is it creates inflammation. The inflammation decreases hormone sensitivity, so your body has to create more hormones because they're not getting into the cells, and it's a vicious cycle. So once again, we've got a ton of resources on this. We don't need to do a stress management workshop tonight because we've already done it. Go back to the podcast. Go to the Real Health Podcast. This is what I would recommend for this. We have a workshop that we did at the office, and there's part one and part two. It's called the Stress Management Workshop. Really, really good info, really good content, really good action steps there. We also have a couple other podcasts. One's called Allostatic Load. I probably shouldn't have named it that because probably nobody listens to it. Because, like, what does that mean? Well, that's rocks in your backpack. We also called it that. Rocks in your backpack is, you know, it's not just mental. It's not just chemical, and it's not just physical. It's all those things are all rocks in your backpack. And some are bigger rocks than others, but allostatic load is the load of all the stresses in your life. So when you decrease chemical stress, you're decreasing your allostatic load. If you start standing up and stretching every hour at your desk job, you're decreasing allostatic load. So anyway, go back and listen to those podcasts. There's also one on adrenal fatigue and adrenal burnout, which is what happens when you get too stressed. So watch those to get some resources for how you can effectively manage your stress, because it's very possible and it's very, very fun, I would say. You know, you feel, you know, to just calm down and to just look around and see the way that everybody else is living their lives and have some inner calm for yourself. There's really nothing better than that. Okay, so the last thing with stress. Okay, so we talked about this before, RT3. So, you know, I want to show you this slide here. I'll leave it up for a minute, you know, so you can read it. So the thyroid producing proper hormones, T4, requires iodine, tyrosine, iron, zinc, selenium, B vitamins, you know, lots of different things as cofactors. Now look over on the right side, proper thyroid hormones inhibited by stress, autoimmune disease, toxins, the conversion, we've talked about that, cellular sensitivity, we're going to talk about that in a second, but I want you to look at the box on the lower left side, okay? So T4 will convert to RT3, reverse T3 is what it's called, in times of stress, okay? Or in times of, you know, trauma, you get injured, your body's going to go into healing and repair mode because it's in that stressful time. But if you're chronically stressed, you know, we always talk about that stress is a great, great thing. Your body does it for a reason. It's for survival. But that's the thing with our society is that it's stress, 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 stress. We don't want to be chronically stressed. When you're chronically stressed, your body creates what's called RT3. And I won't get into this too far, but if you look at, you know, we've already talked about the cross and the goalpost here, the key and the lock, RT3 and T3 have the same key. Okay, so that means that RT3 can get in there first, and then there's no room for T3 to get into the cell. T3 is what needs to get into the cell to go directly to the nucleus and the mitochondria to rev up your metabolism. So that's not good. So stress massively, massively affects thyroid function through reverse T3. Once again, another good resource. Go to our YouTube channel. Dr. Pompa has a very, very good video about true cellular detox, and he talks about that, what that actually means. Okay, and that's actually action step number 4, proper detoxification. So good segue, but you can go to our YouTube channel. We hosted it. It's Align Utah search, and then it's called Why I Still Don't Feel Well. A really great video that talks about T3, RT3, Hashimoto's, and maybe helps you start looking at it from a little bit different perspective. Really, really good video there. So, number 4, proper detoxification. So the first step of that is actually avoiding toxins. Don't let toxins in. And so the ones that, you know, that's any toxin. Okay, so that's good. You know, go back and listen to the podcast, listen to the YouTube videos, listen, read the Real Health blog on where these toxins are coming from. You need to know more about your tap water or your personal care products or your, you know, dental work or your medications or your cooking, you know, your kitchen supplies. Learn about those toxins. Here are the worst ones for the thyroid. Bromines and fluoride are probably the two biggest because they are what's called, they kind of sound like iodine or iodide. Okay, so they actually bind, we're talking about receptors, they bind receptors for iodine. Okay, so see right there, it says proper thyroid hormone production requires iodine is number one on there. And bromines and fluoride are certain things that can actually bind those receptors so that iodine can't get in there. Okay, so iodine deficiency is a big issue. You know, if you talk to, and actually we'll mention it in the supplements, you know, should you take iodine? There's certain people that believe that, you know, 90% of thyroid people need to be taking iodine. Okay, so iodine is really, 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 really crucial. But if you have a lot of bromines or a lot of fluoride, it blocks those receptors. So endocrine disruptors, all the hormone disruptors, that's your plastics. That's your personal care products. That's things like BPA, things like phthalates, things like parabens. Big endocrine disruptors. We talk about those all the time. And the big ones, the major toxins, the major hidden toxins, heavy metals, molds, and infections. Okay, so the one thing that I want to talk about with it comes to detoxification is that is this brain. Okay, so if we're not detoxing the brain, then, you know, we're not detoxing. Okay, we're not detoxing the cells. And so I want to show this. I'm going to share another picture, hopefully. Yes, excellent. Okay, so when we talk about true cellular detox, you know, that we do in our office. See if I can zoom this out a little bit. So this is the True Cellular Detox Roadmap, okay? And so it has three components to really get into the cells. So one is getting the cells working again. That's the five R's of cellular healing. That's what Dr. Pompa has, you know, the program that he has created of how to actually fix cells and get cells working again. But then you look over here, the three phases of this program, and look down at number three, brain. It's so incredibly important for our patients, because so many people have done a detox. They've done a detox, but they, you know, they've done a liver cleanse or they've done a gut cleanse. They've never truly gotten to the cells. They've definitely never gotten to the cells. And most importantly, they've never gotten into the brain. And that's the problem with toxins, is that it's not like you put your skincare product on and that day you're toxic. They store in your body. They bioaccumulate in your cells, and specifically in your fat cells and in your nervous system cells. So you, like a good example, probably the best example, is something like mercury. Mercury is known to lodge and store in the brain, in the nervous system. You know, like lead is known to store in the bones. Mercury is known to store in the brain. So when we do brain detoxes, this is why. If you have toxins in your brain, sometimes the problem is not in the thyroid. Sometimes the problem is not in the gut or the liver. Sometimes the problem is straight up in the brain. So for somebody that has thyroid issues, they have adrenal issues, they have you know, reproductive issues, they have more than one hormonal issue. Why? What connects all those things? Well, the one thing that's controlling them all is the pituitary and hypothalamus control tower there. Okay, so that's massively, massively important to understand that, and to understand, you know, true cell detox. The other thing that true cell detox does is reduces cellular inflammation. So remember when we talked about the inflammation and how it blocks those hormone receptors? Well, we have to reduce inflammation around the cells. And that is the same thing that we're just talking about. The brain cells are one of those places. When those toxins get stored in the cells, they create constant inflammation of that cell membrane, and that has to be reduced. Okay, in true cellular detox, that's exactly what it's designed to do, is to reduce cellular inflammation, get the cells working again. You know, if I go back to get the cells functioning again, because the cells should detox on their own, right? They're designed to detox. Let me pull this up again. And so the five R's: remove the source, regenerate that cell membrane, restore the cellular energy, reduce cellular inflammation, and reestablish something called methylation. Okay, so getting the cells functioning again, really, really important for your hormone sensitivity in general. And pull it up for the last step. The last step. Oh, there's one more slide though that I want to show you that. Here's why. Cellular inflammation, you know, that does blunt hormone sensitivity. That causes hormone resistance, but it also blocks detoxification. So when your body is inflamed, it can't detoxify. So this is a really simple, you know, picture here. And if you picture this being like a graph, and on the left is maybe like a kid. I think of my kids, they're 2 years old. So their inflammation level is really low. So their detoxability is really high. As inflammation goes up through the standard American diet, through stress, all the different kinds of stress, through the things that we just talked about, as inflammation goes up, detoxability goes down. So that's why that's such an important role of true cellular detox. It's not really even about detoxing, which is the weird thing. There are true binders in this system that go in and actually bind toxins and get rid of them. But true cellular detox is really, at the root is fixing cellular inflammation. Because when you fix cellular inflammation, the cells can detox themselves. And that goes right into our last action step of take the right supplements. Okay, taking the right supplements. And once again, I'd encourage you watch that video on our YouTube channel, because Dr. Papa, you know, he does a great job. He talks to this girl that has Hashimoto's, and he asks her, you know, what are you doing for it? What are you taking? And she goes through and she says, well, you know, I take a vitamin D. He said, of course you do. I said, I take a probiotic. Of course you do. I take an omega. Of course you do. And I've talked in the past that those are three really, really, really good supplements if you're healthy and well. Great maintenance supplements. Are they going to fix Hashimoto's? No. Are they going to fix, I mean, anything? Not really. They're going to support. Okay. But taking the right supplements is really, really important. Okay. We like physician grade supplements. Okay. That's something that's, you know, relatively new for me, because we used to carry some other brands that we still have on the shelves that are good brands and they make good quality products. But, you know, if the supplement is available at Sprouts and at Whole Foods and at Walmart or Costco, the chances are that if, you know, the person has a complaint or it's not really doing what it's supposed to do, chances are good that the person will probably never know, or they never complain to the company. And you just take it and you hope that it's working. And you probably remember me talking last year about all the signs that was coming out saying, you know, they checked the labels of supplements and found that they really didn't have what they advertised to have. So you're popping prey. You know, you hope that you're getting what you think you're getting. Physician grade supplements, on the other hand, you can only get them in a clinic. You can only get them through a licensed physician. They tend to have a higher level of quality and credibility, in my opinion. Because if I'm using supplements in my clinic to help remove interference and help support people's natural health ability, and they're not getting well, eventually, you know, I'm not going to keep doing that. So I think that physician grade supplements, you know, are really, really important. So there are supplements to support the thyroid function. There are specific supplements to support the gut function, specific supplements to support liver function, to support hormone sensitivity, to support cellular inflammation. There are specific supplements for each of these things. Okay, and so the last thing I said there is, you know, should you take iodine? So I'll show you some examples here of those supplements. And, you know, if you read a book like Dr. David Brownstein's book here, you finish this book and you'll think, my gosh, I better take some iodine. That's the name of the book. He's the world's leading iodine, you know, researcher. But it's really, really controversial to take iodine. You know, they say the joke that the thyroid in the medical world, it's just, there's a magic bullet. It's take a medication, take Synthroid, take levothyroxine. That's the magic bullet for everybody when they come in with a thyroid issue. Well, the joke is that in the natural world, the magic bullet is take iodine. No matter what your thyroid condition is, take iodine. And I strongly, strongly discourage that. I'm not saying that I strongly discourage iodine. I'm saying if you don't know, it's not something to experiment with, because, you know, hypothyroid is likely the person who would feel the need for iodine. And 80% of hypothyroid is Hashimoto's. And taking iodine when you have Hashimoto's can be dangerous. It can create a Hashimoto's storm, an immune system storm. It can make symptoms worse. So, and it goes back to the fact that Hashimoto's is not a thyroid problem at the root. Hashimoto's is an immune system problem. So if you correct your immune system, you start working on your immune function, and your Hashimoto starts improving, that'd be a good time for iodine, because it does support thyroid tissues, and the immune system has attacked and damaged thyroid tissue. So if you had Hashimoto's for a long time, your thyroid's not ideal, but what caused it was the immune system. So I wanted to make that, you know, distinction with iodine. And I'll show you a couple of the others that we use from Systemic Formulas. We actually did a giveaway on the live webinar. So if you missed that, if you're tuning into the replay, we gave away a couple things. We gave away a thyroid support, GF thyroid here, that's what it's called, bright light. And we gave away what's called a real health assessment. That's a $300 value, and it was the first person that emailed, got each of those, and you know, got emails before the podcast ended asking for those things. But the real health assessment, that is really where we go through and take a complete complete health history. If you're a patient in our office, it's like our history and our paperwork on steroids. But really finding out the root cause, and then what that includes is a follow-up with what's called our real health recommendations, where we'll send a PDF document of the 10 building blocks of real health, and based on your health situation, your health history, give you our current recommendations. So we gave those away anyway. But we gave away this GF thyroid, and this is one that I would say that I recommend to support thyroid function here. And so Systemic Formulas is a physician grade company that we really, really like and are really impressed by. And they really, they use a lot of herbs. Okay, so it's a lot of herbs in combined and really just synergistic ways. Things that even master herbalists have no idea on. It's called herbalomics. They've trademarked that word, herbalomics. So this has Irish moss, pata de vaca, abatua, kelp, you know, different herbs in here. And then it also has RNA, DNA, tissue factors, lung tissue factors, thymus tissue factors, and thyroid tissue factors, which help the herbs go specifically to the tissues that they need to. So really some next level stuff. And the way that we got introduced to these is by the doctors that we've started working with who are seeing people support and reverse chronic conditions. They're supporting them with these supplements. So, you know, the other one that I have sitting right here that I'll show you is, you know, say your problem is here. You can read what that one says. Hopefully it's backwards on my computer, but comes out forwards. Pituitary. Okay. Pituitary. Support the pituitary gland. If you think that if we think that that's where your inflammation is, that's what we need to support. If we're going to do a brain cleanse, a brain detox, we need to support the pituitary. So in our True Cellular Detox, you know, program, the beautiful thing is that instead of having, you know, bottles and bottles of supplements laying around, all these things are in there. There's L-liver to support your liver. There's a probiotic to support your gut. There's what's called Vista 1 and 2, which are membrane regenerators. Regenerate the cell membrane. Restore the cellular energy. Then actually go in and bind the toxins that are stored in those cells that are creating the chronic inflammation. Actually bind those toxins and get rid of them and reset your body's natural, normal ability to heal and function and be well and detoxify. That's the True Cell Detox program. But taking the right supplements, massively, massively important when it comes to supporting any, you know, hormone issue or any health issue. Supplements can be really, really, really powerful. But, you know, just like Dr. Pompa says in that video, so many people today are just taking them because they saw it on Dr. Oz, they read it in Prevention Magazine. They're not taking the highest quality. They're not taking physician grade. They don't really know what they're taking, but it makes them feel good about themselves that they're doing something for their health. They can go eat, you know, cake and ice cream and pizza, but they take their central multivitamin at the end of the night. Makes them feel good about themselves, even though central multivitamins are horrible. But you have to take the right supplements. And so we do customized supplementation plans for people too. A lot of our patients don't know that. We used to do them with lab testing. We still can. You know, you can do tests that will show you need this, this, and this. But now even with the real health assessment based on what you're dealing with, you know, there's general maintenance supportive supplements. And we have all those, you know, on the shelves, the vitamin Ds, the probiotics, the omegas, really, really important. But then there's the more specific, the pituitary, the thyroid, the you know, whatever else we have that's a little bit more specific. So last slide. So those are your five action steps. Okay, so just to run through those again, they are eat a real food diet. Okay, so eat a real food diet. That is number one. It has to start there. And I'd say that these really go in this order. And if you look at the real food pyramid, they absolutely do. So eating a real food diet is on the foundation. Maintaining a healthy gut is the foundation. Stress is the next level up on the real food pyramid. Proper cellular detoxification, reducing inflammation, getting the cells detoxing again, and then taking the right supplements. So the last slide we have here, thank you guys for for staying tuned and sticking with us to the end here. First off, you know, the gut health webinar that's coming up, we will definitely be doing more giveaways because we want to encourage people to tune into the webinars live. So it was really fun to do the giveaways, have people send us emails right away asking for those giveaways. And, you know, we're really happy with the people that won those. So the gut health webinar is going to have even more free giveaways to tune in that night live. Tuesday, October 4th, 7 p.m. You can go ahead and sign up now at www.wealignutah.com/gut health. Okay, the last webinar is actually available at that link below. It's www.wealignutah, which is our website, of course, /autoimmune-disease-webinar. Okay, so go and check that webinar out. And you know, you just heard this one, and then tune in for the next one. And then make sure while you're on the website, you know, check it out, because it is, even if you checked it out, you know, a month ago, it's completely different now, because the whole website itself is only about 2 months old. So we're still adding, we're still ironing things out, and still just working on it, quite frankly, you know, not just kinks and mistakes, but just adding to it and putting a lot of work in on it. So if you check the Real Health blog, I think you'll be impressed with the articles that we have up there. You know, some are scientific, you know, wellness articles written by me, but there's great recipes. There's amazing recipes, some really good stuff. There's great articles on essential oils. There's a ton of good resources on the Real Health blog. We have the Real Health podcast, okay, which is www.realhealthwithdrtaylor.com. Or you can find it on iTunes, or you can get to it, you know, through the website. And keep your eye out for upcoming articles on the microbiome, on top tips for taking probiotics. Because as I'm starting to put together the content for this gut health webinar, you know, once again, just like tonight, we can't take all your time. So we're going to be able to tell you what we can. But then, you know, through some of these videos and articles, for those that want to dive a little bit deeper, you can. Okay, so new podcast episodes are coming out all the time. An upcoming one that I like is on heavy metals and dementia. So heavy metal toxicity, Alzheimer's, and dementia. So just keep your eyes on it. We got a lot coming out this fall, a lot of big things planned. But otherwise, thank you guys so much for tuning in. Hopefully everybody got something out of this. If you tuned into the original webinar and then you go back to watch the replay, hopefully these slides work a little bit better and you can see those a little bit better. But it's great content. Hopefully you see how important it is for every single person for their overall health. So as always, be blessed, and we'll talk to you guys Tuesday, October 4th at 7 p.m.